Okay, are there any questions?
Humans were made for God's grace, but not the use intended. What did he mean by that?
Okay, we are made for God's grace, right? Meaning that that's what this image of the symbol represents, the fact that we have a shaft through our affects, right? The snowman one. What this is, represents is the fact that to work the way that we are supposed to, right? For our appetites and our emotions, really to obey easily our intellect and our will, we need God's grace. What I said, or at least I intended to say, is that with the fall, we have lost access. We no longer have God's grace because we've rejected Adam and Eve, and Adam and Eve on behalf of all of humanity have rejected this communion with God. And without communion with God, we have no grace. And without this grace, this original grace, we become disintegrated. Right? So now we no longer operate in the way that we were intended. Our appetites and our emotions can run wild. And if we don't train them, if we don't master them, then they will master us. And oftentimes, that's the experience of many of us that have, that in many ways, we're much more mastered by our appetites, by our emotions, than we have mastery over them. And, but we can get it, right? That's our task. We'll talk more about next time how we achieve that. Next, our next lesson, we'll be talking about how we achieve this mastery, being cooperating, I mean, beyond just human effort alone.
How would you say for someone who is being mastered by their affects, what would be the first step to saying no to oneself? I mean, of course, it would be to say no to oneself, but even right. The background to that, how would you bring about that switch of who the master is?
Well, that's a good question. Many times it depends on how much somebody is mastered by their appetites and their emotions, right? We can go from vices, you know, from bad habits, if you will, to vices where they're almost ingrained, to kind of addictions that are really pathological. And depending on where we are on that spectrum, we may need different types of assistance. Right? The more we are with regard to addictions, we might need to use coping mechanisms, right, that can help us to avoid getting into these while we build our self-mastery. The first step, ultimately, for any of these is to recognize that you have a problem, right? To recognize that just pursuing pleasure, right, as we had talked about in the first session, pursuing pleasure it seems to be that which is going to make us happy. But we recognize very soon afterwards, as the novelty wears off, right, as the, you know, the addiction or as the dopamine no longer has the same kind of response, that we become miserable because we become enslaved to chasing after this particular pleasure. And it no longer does to us what it did before. So the blinders come off. Generally, that's when we find out that that we have a problem. Though there are so many other good things around us, we may be off to something else as well. Understanding really that you're not, that happiness, right, that self-mastery is really what we want, is the key. One of the ways that we can see that really is what we want, right, is many of us, most of us, I suppose, in some regard, has seen somebody else, right, that seems to have mastery over themselves in an area that we don't. And we wish, and we say, I wish I had their self-mastery, or I wish I had their self-control or their willpower. Right? It may or may not be the case that they do, that being beside the point. We recognize that we are made to be masters of ourselves. Being able to come to this recognition and this realization and recognize that that's really what we want, to be able to fully possess ourselves is the first step. The next step is to start to address the reason or the rationale for our lack of self-mastery, for our bad habit or vice. in many cases, it's going to be very difficult to, the more and more we are attached to it, the more and more difficult it's going to be. And it might be at some point, it might be something that really is nearly humanly impossible to overcome. Then we need supernatural help. Then we need supernatural help. That will be the next time, but then we'll talk about that. But to the degree that we're able to, right, we end up first looking at the good that we're attracted to, and don't make the mistake of saying it's bad. Right? Making the mistake of saying it's bad leaves us open to being attracted to it again. We may be able to develop an ability to say no to it, but we're not going to improve our self-mastery either. We have to acknowledge its goodness in itself, depending on what it is, right? Depending on what it is. There is some good about it that we're attracted to, right? But it, for whatever reason, the circumstances, right, it's not a good for me. Now, we'll do a talk later on morality, right? There are certain, things that we're attracted to that are inherent evils, right? But there's still something good about that evil that attracts us, even though you can never do that kind of act for a particular reason. We'll talk about why that is later. But affirming the good, but saying no because it's not good for me, right? And taking that energy and recognizing that energy, and using that energy that's moving us towards this thing we're attracted to for something good. Important in part of this is to start to be attentive to what we're thinking and what we're feeling, being present to ourselves, right? You see, for the appetites to move us, the intellect first becomes aware of the good and conveys that automatically to the appetites, right, and the emotions. As soon as we become aware of the good, if we are present to ourselves, we need to recognize immediately, right, that it's not a good for us if it's not, and move ourselves to some other good, make this decision before the appetites, before the emotions kick in. Once they kick in, then we have the energy to deal with, and it becomes much more difficult. So presence to ourselves, attention to what we're thinking, and attention to what we're feeling, can keep nip it in the bud the earlier you catch it. But once it gets far enough, then it becomes very difficult. Right? It becomes very difficult, because that's what the appetites and the emotions are for. Almost to keep you from being able to say no, right? Almost to keep you from being able to say no, to try to move you towards some good. So it takes a lot of effort. That's in a nutshell.
And God along the way is giving you graces, right? Like a divine push of some kind.
Yeah, we haven't gotten to that point yet. We'll talk about grace next one. But there are two ways that God's grace works on us, right? Exteriorly, which is which everybody can receive.
Life preserver.
Well, it's more like an invitation. It's what we might call this little thought that's put in the back of our minds, that God is inviting us towards the good, right? Whether you can receive grace, whether you can receive what's called sanctifying grace or not, right? Ultimately, whether you're baptized or not, everybody can receive and does receive that kind of grace. But the other type of grace, the grace that penetrates us, right? This is only going to be, this wasn't a reality for humanity until Pentecost, which we'll talk about next time. Right? So we're kind of talking about things before Pentecost at this point. Next week we'll talk about how grace works. But ultimately what it does is it works with nature. right? Grace works with nature. Grace is infinite, right? We don't receive it infinitely, but grace is infinite. But as we see here, grace is made for nature. Grace heals fallen nature, it pure elevates it, and it perfects it. But we still have to do our part, right? We don't have to be math majors to remember that zero times infinity is still zero, right? If we don't provide anything, then it's not a God's, you know, God's household is not a welfare state. If we don't contribute anything, he's not going to force us against our will. So we have to, it's not passive. It's not quietus. We have to cooperate with it. And we cooperate with it in what, in the virtues, right? We'll talk a little bit more about the virtues, but the virtues generally are their justice. Always doing the right, giving God what is his due and giving others what is their due, right? Always being courageous, even in the small things, saying no to, and some of the most difficult, I mean, you know, oftentimes we think about courage as like Daniel in the den, you know, the lion's den. But sometimes what the most courageous thing is to say no to your contemporaries, right? That kind of death is the most difficult, being able to say no to your friends who are leading you in a direction that you ought not to go. Sometimes it's more difficult. The temperance, right? Using the goods of the earth rightly, not overusing them or underusing them, right? And prudence, right? Always choosing the good in the most appropriate way, right? Coming about the good in the most appropriate way. We have to do these in the small things, right? Just like if you were going to run a marathon, be able to do the big difficult things, you have to start doing them in the small things. To build yourself up to that. But yes.
Yeah, I like the description of the snowman disintegrated or destructed. And I look at it and I see society and the encouragement to stay apart. I realize that we're sitting here and we're wanting to learn how to put our snowman back together, and that's why we're creating this for others too. But as a church, how do we encourage people to see this process when so much of society is encouraging, reinforcing this type of...
The exact opposite.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, with every problem, right, as Pope Francis is encyclical just pointed out, everything's connected. Mm-hmm. Right? Everything is connected. You can't, it's, you know, in the West, we're very good at breaking things into pieces and parts, and that really is part of his critique. It's a very important critique of society. And we try to fix things through technical means and, you know, in pieces and parts. But it's not going to ever work unless we do it all at once. It's got to start in the family. But the families, in general, are no place for doing it right now, right? So there has to be leadership. There has to be leadership from, you know, from bishops and priests, right? And lay people who know this. But in general, we don't have enough bishops, priests, and lay people that know that, you know, that know this to be able to do it. Or at least to be able to do it effectively. So we need to work very much on vocations and improving not just the number of vocations, but, you know, the vocations formation that we have. But you need families to be able to provide for that, right? So we're gonna have, I mean, what we have to do is recognize that in one sense, you know, it could seem like an insoluble problem, but we have to start someplace. We have to start and this is kind of what we're doing here as well. We're starting someplace. We're starting to do those things that we can do around us. Right? And we may not see the fruit of it. I mean, most of us sitting here, maybe one or two of us might, but most of us probably will not see the fruits of this. But we have to start it now. We have to be right. We have to be courageous enough to engage in things that we may not ever see the results of, but they will eventually benefit, right? And to the degree that we cooperate with God's plan, to the degree that we offer the sufferings, right, because we don't see fruits of what it is that we are doing, we, you know, we suffer with seeing the consequences for those that we love, right? Those that we know, or, you know, our fellow citizens who are being led down the primrose path, you know, to destruction. Those types of things, right, those are little white martyrs. Those really are the seeds of the church. That's the grace that comes from that, that God can, that we cooperate, or in cooperating with the cross, right, that's applied to help to remedy things. So in many ways, right, our being faithful is going to be, you know, to what it is we're called to, is going to be much more efficacious than even the actual programs that we put in place right now. So we always have to recognize that, because otherwise we might just throw up our hands and say, and be defeatist. But we're not. We have this eschatological hope, because we know we've already, you know, we've got the book, and we've already got the, you know, the last chapter. We know who wins. We know how it ends up. We're in the middle of it. We haven't read about our particular part.
I guess because it's hard to watch people that you know and love going down that path, and because of free will, not a whole lot you can do about it other than live your life as a model.
Right.
And
model.
And sacrifice for them, right? Sacrifice. One of the things that we have to remember, the image of Jesus in the when he comes down from the Mount of Transfiguration, I think it was, right? And his disciples had been trying to expel this demon, right? And the demon wouldn't come out. They couldn't command to come out. And what was his response to them? Well, this kind only comes out through much prayer and fasting. This is what unifies us. The fasting unifying us with the cross, right? And the prayer unifying us with Jesus Christ himself. This helps to transform, this makes the efficacy of the cross present the more we pray and fast. So we have to be careful not to sell short. Our Americanism leads us to want to go out and put a program in place and, you know, within the next quarter, should be able to show what kind of boost for it. To be able to show, this is the value added. We're not going to, it's not the way that God works. It's going to be more fidelity.
Good answer.
The giant elephant.
Yes.
You said the way we understand joy is different from God's joy. You mean that pertains to, like, he is the author, like, where the reader? Is that what you mean?
Well, what I meant to say is that joy, God is the author of joy, right? God is, because God creates, when God creates, right, he is really all there is. And when he creates, he has nothing else. He can't be inspired.
Yeah, joy for us, right? Joy.
Well, joy for us is somehow participating in what God is. God is eternal joy. But God is infinite joy. But God doesn't change, but God is always active. So, in a certain sense, God can't, we'll go in part two of this, we'll go into a lot more detail about it. But at this point, it's really important to recognize that because God can't change, he's always faithful, he's always the same. He doesn't get mad in the way we understand mad, because we go from one state to the next. He's always the same, always even keel. It's always active. We experience joy as going from a state of non-joy, right, to being joyful, and the joy lasts for a period of time. Joy lasts much longer than pleasure, but the joy eventually subsides, right, and we need to experience it again. Joy comes about, authentic joy comes about, primarily from loving rightly. Really, love, and the definition of love is really recognizing what the good of the other person is and really doing their authentic good regardless of what it does for us. When we become inward turned and we're thinking too much about ourselves, how we feel, Some of us can be medically hypochondriacs, right? Where we're wondering, am I sick? Some of us can be emotional hypochondriacs. Am I happy? Right? That kind of inward term Satan uses to keep us inside of ourselves. And that's exactly what we are not. We are not meant to be inward turned. We're meant to be giving ourselves to others. Right? This is the irony of God, the way that God is, the way that God creates. We only find our fulfillment, right? We only become more who we are by giving ourselves away. Because of this, we're tempted to think we become happy, we fulfill ourselves by taking, but we don't. That actually, especially in relationships, if we take and we don't give first, then we actually don't fulfill ourselves. Ultimately, we become miserable. So what I'm saying is that when we experience joy, it's only a small foretaste of what joy is in God. But the joy that we will experience in heaven, right, is, even though it won't be his exact joy, this joy that we share in will be beyond anything that we can imagine. Right? The greatest of everything that we can experience, the greatest emotions that we can experience, all of those will coalesce into this eternal act, and we will never become tired of it, right? It will never become, it will be ever new.